Thank you. My name is Helen Kim. I'm a Senior Vice President in Business Banking at Bank of America, Merrill Lynch. I have my colleagues here today. Charlotte Starfire is a Director of Global Trade Supply Chain Solutions. And Jessica Platt, she's Global Rates and Currencies Origination. We're going to be presenting on the topic of going global, mechanics of expanding internationally. We'd like to first thank Illinois Manufacturer Association for hosting this event, and thank you for sponsoring the breakfast this morning. So before we get started, I'd like to tell you a story about Caterpillar. You know about Caterpillar. Let's see. In the 1980s, Caterpillar had found itself in a fierce battle with its Japanese rival, Komatsu Limited. Does anybody know the story? Okay, so Caterpillar and Komatsu, they're both in earth-moving equipment business, right? So in the 80s, when Komatsu was coming to United States and they were competing with Caterpillar, their ambition was summed up in one simple slogan in Japanese, Maru-si. Translated into English, encounter Caterpillar. Their strategy was to find weakness in Caterpillar and attack all its market segment. In MBA jargon, they say that it's also known as loose brick strategy, where one's competition looks for loose brick in the competitor's wall with hopes of eventually tearing down the whole wall. So it sounds like something like you see in a movie, in Japanese movie, where they're just slashing all the competitors. But Komatsu's attack on Caterpillar in the 1980s came at a bad time for Caterpillar. They were going through some major issues with labor costs and high overhead expenses. And on top of it, they were having high US dollar versus Japanese yen relationship. So the CEO at the time had to make some quick decisions and figure things out and fix it. And so he took a couple of, he made some tough decisions. And what he did was he began laying off a large percentage of workers. And then he began outsourcing, like warehousing and production. And that caused a lot of issues with the union laborers. So, but he did that. And then the research and development, he pushed that out to the factories. And what was happening at the time at Caterpillar was that they were already a global company, and they had presence in France and Brazil and Japan. And he began picking out senior managers to oversee each individual subsidiaries to be responsible for all of the operation. He gave them 100% control to make decisions. And up until then, all of their operational, the production, warehousing, product designing, everything was done in Peoria, Illinois. So that was causing a lot of issues. And on top of it, with the labor issues were big problems for Caterpillar. So with a combination of all the restructuring of the operational issues and with assigning the senior managers to oversee the branches, the subsidiaries, at the end of the restructuring, Peoria lost about 20,000 high-wage union jobs, and it actually saved the company. So interesting thing is that when some of the senior managers, when they got picked by the headquarters, were sent to the subsidiary to manage, some of them had never seen a P&L statement. And so all of a sudden, they had this humongous authority to make decisions. And then at the end of the year, they were called on it to make profit. So some of them actually got demoted, and some of them began doing really well. So by 1995, they regained the market share, and they became number one in every market that they served, except in Japan. They were number two. But throughout the 1990s, Caterpillar started making record earnings, and they recovered. But ironically, though, these days, Caterpillar is in the same situation, almost similar situation, because of the major markets that they're working with have been pretty hard, like construction, mining, energy industries. And because of that, their customers have cut back on their, or they're holding back on their spending. So it's reflected on Caterpillar stock prices. It's down by 25% in 2015. But a lot of the experts are saying that that they're going to be okay because they made some major changes inside, and by 2015 they should be recovering. So that's, you know, that's what happened. But these days, though, you know, when we listen to the news and we listen to the presidential candidates speaking about the manufacturing industries and job sectors, people say how bad it is, and it feels bad when you're starting to listen to this politicians speaking about the market. But the thing is, when you take two surveys, one completed by RSM US, one by Bank of America, just to give you some idea about the background about this survey, is the RSM US, formerly known as McLaughlin, they go out and they talk to 1,660 CFOs worldwide. And most of them are from manufacturing and distribution industries. And they give them a series of questions on what they think about the market, what their strategies are, what they're going to do going forward. And this is what they said. They said that more than 35% of the companies are thriving, and 74% are showing revenue growth, and most of them are very optimistic about the economic growth in U.S. market as well, more in U.S. market than other parts of the world. And then for 2016, they're planning to report healthy profits and healthy sales growth. And because U.S. economy is doing so well, there more than half of them are planning to come to United States to compete here, and they're going to sell their products and services. If you look at the second report by Bank of America has been doing this survey since 1989, and they hired Granite Research Consulting Company to come and interview 500 financial executives from American companies nationwide, and this is what the CFOs are saying. They're saying that more than 90% of the CFOs are saying that they're going to grow sales in 2016, and more than half of them are going to hire new full-time employees. And then they're going to also take some proactive measures, updating their technology, strengthening their balance sheet, and pursuing M&A deals, which makes sense because U.S. dollar is very strong right now, so that's what they're going to do. But the thing that they also say is that they're going to go out to international market to expand sales, and they're seeing 34% or more opportunities outside of United States, and that makes sense. Someone said that 95% of the population is outside of United States. So more and more manufacturers should look at the global market and look at their operation and really focus on updating the technology, strengthening their balance sheet, and also in particularly to innovation. So we could take a look at Illinois and what export actually means for Illinois and the foreign investments coming into Illinois. This information we were able to get from International Trade Administration. A lot of the information that you're looking for to help you to expand globally, you can find it from export.gov or trade.gov. This is available to you free of charge. So if you look at the top section where it says export support jobs, to date, 2015, $2.23 trillion worth of exports were sent out of United States from its export to other countries. And from that effort, 11.7 million jobs were created for United States. And out of that, 345,000 jobs were in specific to Illinois. So that's a big number, I think. Out of those, $2.23 trillion worth of goods and services were produced by 22,000 companies in Illinois. And 90% of the companies are small to medium-sized enterprises with less than 500 employees. So that's pretty substantial. Then if you look at the right-hand corner at the bottom, this is where non-US companies are coming into United States. And they are spending money, opening factories, hiring employees. And the biggest country coming into United States, the United Kingdom, followed by Japan, and Germany and France. These companies have hired about 290,000 employees in our market. So that's very, very good. And then the Illinois metropolitan area, that's Chicago, Elgin, and Naperville, is responsible for exporting about $47 billion, Peoria, $11 billion, and Davenport, Moline, and Rock Island, $6.6 billion. And then Rockford and Decatur, $2.5 billion and $2 billion, respectively. So if you look at this slide and you look at Illinois exporting for Illinois world market, so far in 2015, $63.4 billion were exported of goods and services from Illinois. And to date, United States has free trade agreements with 20 countries. Now about $34 billion were exported to those countries with free trade agreements. And then the top five export industries are machineries, chemicals, and computer electronic products. And then the countries that we export mostly to is Canada with $17.4 million. And then followed with China, Mexico, and then China. So these are very good numbers, and especially a motivation for you to start looking at global market, global sales. And with that, I want to introduce Charlotte Starfire. She is our Director of Global Trade Supply Chain Solutions, and she flew in just so she can help us with this presentation. And let me introduce Charlotte's background for you. Mrs. Starfire works with clients to provide innovative transactional technology and finance solutions to meet their global needs and those related to trade and supply chain finance. Ms. Starfire has enjoyed many years in international banking, offering services including direct cross-border lending, international correspondent banking, export working capital financing, financing the U.S. subsidiary operations of foreign corporations, risk mitigation, and trade services, as well as supply chain finance. She has led numerous international economic development initiatives. She chaired the Florida District Export Council, and appointed by the U.S. Secretary of Commerce. And she also served on the National District Export Council and co-founded Export University, Inc. She currently serves on the steering committee for the Metro Atlanta Export Initiatives and is active in the Atlanta World Affairs Council. She holds a degree in Latin American Studies from Tulane University and has working proficiency in Spanish and Portuguese. So here's Ms. Starfire.
I kind of laugh at the bio. You know, if you've been around long enough, you've done some stuff. That's all I can say. You know. So anyway, thank you so much. I do live in Atlanta, and it is in the East Coast. However, I grew up in Ohio, so I'm very comfortable in the Midwest. So thank you so much for welcoming me here today. And my folks are originally from Colorado, so really I'm much stronger in that sort of Midwest thing. So I appreciate being here today, and I know a lot of you represent or are here to learn about how you can support your clients as they go global. And I think that in today's world, you know, we've just seen it so firsthand, particularly during the economic crisis, you know, in this past decade. We really saw that those companies that were diversified in terms of their client base, or in terms of their vendor base, or in terms of their overall strategies, those companies that were diversified from a global perspective survived and thrived. The International Trade Administration did some research that suggested that companies that, manufacturers in particular, that were involved in exporting during the economic downturn grew during that period of time by over 40%, and those that were not involved in exporting, actually many of them lost their businesses. I mean, they went down. So the truth of the matter is, you know, in any financial area that you look at, diversification is critical, right? Whether that's our own personal investments, but as a business, you know, it's very important to diversify both your vendor relationships as well as your client relationships, and to be engaged globally on both those fronts will protect you against, you know, market changes. So that's what we really are going to focus on, those companies today which are looking to expand globally. And we're going to be talking about risk mitigation, we're going to be talking about financing strategies, and basically I'll try to put that within kind of the broader context of strategic decision making as well. But I will kind of go into some of the nuts and bolts, I think, with those of you that are CPAs, law firms, and those of you that are actually involved in the manufacturing, some of the nuts and bolts is helpful. So, you know, when I'm talking to companies that are involved in international trade, you know, whether they're an importer or an exporter, I always have to remember that the needs of the importer from a risk perspective and the needs of the exporter from a risk perspective are actually diametrically opposed, right? Because if I'm an exporter, you know, my most perfect solution is a client who's going to pay me cash in advance, right? I got money on the barrelhead, and then I'll deliver the product, right? If I'm the importer, it's the exact opposite. If I'm the importer, the last thing I want is my vendor to say, you got to give me cash in advance. So, you know, a lot of what we do at Bank of America and what other banks do in terms of trade finance support is to find a common middle ground between those two polarities of risk perspective. So when we talk about the risks, you know, particularly the financial risks in going global, you know, we're looking at a lot of things, and it's funny because with my foreign exchange partner here, they're always talking about the currency risk, okay? And that is one risk. But there's a lot of other financial risks when you're going global. If you're an exporter, for example, you have to think about both the political risk of that country that you're selling into, as well as the commercial risk, which is the buyer, the specific buyer. And the commercial risk is not dissimilar to the risk I have if I'm an exporter and I'm based in Florida and I'm selling to somebody in Georgia, right? I have to know my client. I have to know, do they have the wherewithal to honor the contractual obligation we're entering into, right? But but what's really different is that buyer that I'm selling to, let's say in the case of Brazil, has a completely different set of regulatory parameters that they have to adhere to. Access to credit information to evaluate that buyer in Brazil may be very, very different than the information that might be readily available to me if I'm selling to somebody in Georgia, right? So it's harder to assess that commercial risk. And then I've got the political risk, the country risk of whatever country it is. And I find particularly in the privately held company space, entrepreneurial space, a lot of times it's the CEO, it's the owner who's, you know, leading their international strategy, and they often take risks that I'm not sure they're fully assessing, truthfully. They think that because nowadays with the internet and cell phones and whatever, that they know their clients and they kind of jump into stuff. Maybe they'll find a partner in that country and they kind of just jump into it. And then after the fact, they learn about the regulatory environment there. You know, I can't tell you how many of them call me and they go, "We've opened up a partnership, you know, with somebody in Brazil, but we can't even open a bank account there. What the heck? Why won't they let us open a bank account?" I'm like, "Well, do you know how hard it is for a Brazilian company to open a bank account in the United States? It's not easy here either. I mean, we've got regulatory hurdles on both sides to address. Of course, we make it easier for the Brazilian investor, don't we?" But so anyway, there's that, and then, you know, the whole documentary risk thing. I'll go into that today in more detail, but honestly, the devil's in the details in international trade. It really is. You know, you're dealing with customs regulations. You're dealing with, you know, ITAR regulations. You're dealing with all kinds of compliance stuff, and the devil's in the details. And the documentation's important. And then, you know, obviously the transportation risk. How many of you are aware that under the rule of commons, under international shipments, for example, most shipping lines, the standard is, if you have a container on a ship and the ship goes down, through the law of commons, the total value of the ship and the containment, the stuff that's on the ship, is that value is just divided up equally among whoever stuff is on that ship, and that's what you're responsible for. Now, most insurance policies write protection against that, but if you aren't even aware of that and don't read the policy carefully and so forth, how many of your clients do you think really are aware of that? Again, the devil's in the details, right? So risk is something that has to be thought through. Oh well. When I was talking about the importer and the exporter, what this slide shows is that the polar opposite of the risk perspective, and how the various trade products that we offer, that banks offer, kind of helps to even out that risk. So, for example, if I'm the exporter, I'm selling, so my risk is to that overseas buyer. Obviously, cash in advance is my least risky and my most favored position, least favorite to the importer. So the next, taking us towards the middle line, would be an export letter of credit, right? So in that case, the buyer's bank is committing to pay the exporter, so it's mitigating that risk. You have both confirmed letters of credit and advised letters of credit. I'll go into more detail, but each of them kind of gets us a little bit closer to the midline. And then you have documentary collections, which is not as secure as a letter of credit, but it's better than open accounts. So we kind of have this continuum of products. And of course, if you're representing an importer, the exact opposite would be the case. If I'm an importer, paying cash in advance is highly unfavorable. Letter of credit is better, but not the best. Because you're going to have your bank line in place, and you're going to have to pay fees and all that kind of stuff. Although there are advantages to the importer for using letter of credit too, because it mitigates the risk of their behavior that they're relying the vendor to perform. But then documentary collection is better than the letter of credit from a cost perspective, and a little bit easier, but you're not controlling your vendor as much. So anyway, it's this continuum. So letter of credit, again, the bank that issues the letter of credit is the bank that the importer works with. So the importer goes to their bank, asks them to issue the letter of credit, and it's done against their line of credit, or it's going to be secured with cash. As an exporter, that's important to think about, because let's say in the case of Brazil, or let's say in the case of Well, a lot of the developing countries where the banking system is not so liquid as it is in the United States, in those countries, availability of those lines of credit for the importer can be a little challenging. So while it's really a great product for the exporter because it's secure, he has to understand when he's exporting that if he's dealing with competition, maybe the buyer cannot secure that letter of credit. Now, maybe they can't secure because they don't have the credit worthiness to do so. Red flag, you know? Or maybe it's just because, you know, of the costs associated or what have you. So again, it's know the client. It's important to know the client and understand those dynamics. But for the exporter, and I can tell you that at Bank of America, because we have such a huge client base, it's really interesting because we can see behaviors across all spans. So large corporate, middle market, business banking, we can see all of that activity. And I can tell you that even in the large corporate space, very large active exporters, they still use letters of credit because it's efficient, it's secure for them. So it takes the risk away from the buyer and places it with the buyer's bank. From the exporter's perspective, the parties to the letter of credit, you have the sales contract that underlines the transaction between the buyer and the seller. Then you have the actual application of the letter of credit, which is between the buyer and their bank. And then you have the actual letter of credit, which is between the buyer's bank and the beneficiary, the exporter. Or in the case of a confirmed letter of credit, it's actually a contract between the opening bank and the confirming bank. And then the confirming bank has an obligation to the beneficiary. I'll go into more detail about that. So the applicant, again, is the buyer of the goods. The beneficiary would be the exporter. The issuing bank is the buyer's bank. Now, and the advising or confirming bank is going to be the bank that is supporting the exporter on this. If it's a U.S. exporter, it'd be here in the United States, right? So sometimes exporters don't understand how they get this letter of credit that comes in from some bank they've never worked with before. They're like, well, I want it to go through my bank. You know, and maybe they work with like a community bank or something, and they're like, why did this go through some big, you know, Bank of America or something? And it's because Bank of America has thousands of correspondent banks around the world. So the opening bank has to send it to a bank that they have a relationship with. They can't just get it to any bank because they need the bank on this end to be able to verify that it's a valid transaction, et cetera, et cetera. And if the letter of credit's confirmed, the confirming bank, let's say Bank of America, we have to underwrite the opening bank because we're actually taking credit risk with that opening bank when we add our confirmation. So that's why sometimes the letters of credit come in through a bank that your customer may not know. So that's one reason why working with a larger bank that has those international capabilities can help your client, because then the statistical probability of the letter of credit being able to go through their bank is going to be easier, right? I mean, pretty much our clients, they can say they want the letter of credit to come through Bank of America. You know what I mean? When I've worked for some regional banks, that's harder to make that happen all the time. So again, the confirmation is where the bank here in the United States actually takes the risk of the opening bank, and we commit to pay the beneficiary. So the benefit of that is not only does the exporter no longer have credit risk with this opening bank, let's say it's some bank in Brazil, they don't know if they're going to be solid and solvent and live up to their obligations, right? So we're taking that risk, but also we have the say-so as the confirming bank as to whether the documents comply or not. When the exporter ships and they submit all the documentation proving that they've shipped, our team is reviewing that paperwork, and we've taken on the obligation to review that and make sure that everything's in order. So That's a real benefit in addition to just the credit risk benefit. Make sense? Any questions about that? So this is kind of the flow chart of a letter of credit. I mean, it's, you know, the buyer and the seller work out their contract, and then the exporter, the supplier, goes ahead and, you know, prepares the goods and so forth, and they ship the goods over to the buyer, and then but the paperwork goes to the bank, right? We don't have anything to do with goods. We don't know if we don't really know if the exporter shipped a bunch of empty boxes. If their invoice says 10,000 widgets and the bill of lading says 10,000 widgets that weigh X amount of pounds and there's a dollar value associated with that, we don't know really if the boxes are empty, right? Just to know that. So the documents go to the bank, and then we review those documents, assuming everything's in order. If we're the confirming bank, we would go ahead and remit the payment to the supplier, the seller, and we will claim reimbursement from the opening bank. If we're the advising bank, we didn't confirm when we get the shipping documents in. If they're in order, we'll send a swift electronic communication to the opening bank, say the documents are in order, may we effect payment and claim reimbursement, and they'll usually say yes. Sometimes, depending on the wording in the letter of credit, we have to physically send the documents to the opening bank for them to physically review before they're going to give the okay to pay, which is going to add time to your client's DSO, day sales outstanding, right? The turnaround time will be longer. So, but anyway, that's kind of how it flows. We have large commodity exporters, for example, and those shipments are occurring every single day. We're getting processing every single day. The turnaround time is you know, I mean, I have a cotton exporter. They are tracking their DSO almost by the hour, let me tell you. I mean, they are on it, and they're presenting letter credit documentation every day, and with those kinds of companies, you know, it really boils down to how is the letter credit worded? How quickly can the bank claim for payment? And then also they get really smart about what documents they're going to work with under the letter credit. So,
what is the issue with shipped, received, rejected? Ship it,
he
received it, but...
Well, under a letter of credit, the payment has nothing to do with the goods being received. It has to do with the documents being presented to the bank. The buyer cannot pick up the goods and even see if the goods meet their specifications. That payment's already occurred. Under the letter of credit, because it's bank to bank. The banks make that decision based on the paperwork. So again, the paperwork is important. But the buyer can't even go pick up the goods until the payment has been made, or until the bank that's issued the letter of credit has agreed and committed to a payment at a future date. Sometimes if there's a time draft, for example, a 60-day draft, the opening bank still has to accept that obligation to pay at 60 days before the buyer can pick up the goods. So it has nothing to do with the physical delivery of the goods. It has to do with the documentation under the letter of credit.
So how does that protect the buyer at all? What if the boxes have no widgets?
Well, and that's where the buyers, they do have to understand that a letter of credit doesn't deal with the physical goods. However, you know, it does mandate certain behaviors on the part of the exporter. They have to present detailed documentation, and that documentation has to be prepared in a very precise manner, and the invoice has to match up to the bill of lading. The bill of lading has to match up to the packing list, and the packing list has to tie in with the insurance certificate. They have to ship within a certain time frame. They have to use the ports that are designated. So you're controlling, it's reducing, but you don't have total. Yeah. You're improving the documentation, though, if you have to go to court. So one of the things, and I'm not going to go over all of this here, but one of the things that I think is so important, a checklist like this for your client, if they're an exporter or an importer, is important for them to have. Because again, the devil's in the details and in the documentation, and these are a lot of the areas that they need to think about as they're negotiating and agreeing to the terms of the letter of credit, or as they are reviewing a letter of credit that comes in. So, as I said, in that risk continuum, after a letter of credit, which is most the next most secure for an exporter after cash in advance, the next most secure for an exporter is the documentary collection. If I'm the importer, this is a little bit easier for me than obtaining a letter of credit. For the exporter, it's a little less secure than getting a letter of credit. So it's kind of in that middle ground, the documentary collection. The way it works is when the exporter ships, the shipping documents, the invoice, the bill of lading, the packing list, all that kind of stuff, physically go from the exporter's bank to the importer's bank. And the importer's bank contacts the importer and says, hey, we've got these documents at your risk and disposal. Are you going to pay for these goods? And the importer says yes or no. If no, those documents go back to the exporter. He can find another buyer in that country because the goods have already shipped at that point, right? But the title document, the bill of lading, would still be in their control. If, on the other hand, the buyer wants to pay, they would pay and the documents would be released to them so they could pick up the goods. The bill of lading is the critical document because it's the document that allows the importer to go to the port or go to the airport and pick up the goods. So you're kind of controlling access to that bill of lading based on the payment. But it's not a bank, you don't have the bank commitment to pay. So if the buyer says, you know what, I found a better price, or you know what, the market's completely crashed and I don't need more cotton, they don't have to pay. There's no obligation to pay on a documentary collection. Yeah. So it's used, some countries like Egypt right now will not allow any payments to go to outside vendors for product coming into Egypt unless it's documented under a letter of credit or a documentary collection, because they want to make sure that there's no flight capital leaving the country. So they want to make sure that every amount of money leaving the country is tied to actual trade transactions. And there are other countries that do the same thing. Bangladesh does the same thing. So sometimes the documentary collection is used for that reason, for, you know, to kind of document the trade flows. But it's also used between buyers and sellers when there's usually when there's a strong relationship between the two of them, but they're not quite ready to go pure open account. But it's not as secure as a letter of credit. You can do a document against payment, so that's when the documents hit the buyer's bank. Buyer's bank calls the buyer, says, hey, you want to pay? The buyer says, yeah, debit my account, wire the funds. That's a document against payment. Documents against acceptance is the buyer's bank calls the buyer and they say, hey, we've got your documents. There's a 60-day draft on this, so you owe the money in 60 days. Are you going to commit to that? And the buyer actually signs the draft committing to pay in 60 days, but it does not have a bank guarantee on it. So the exporter here is taking that written commitment on that draft from the buyer in whatever country that they will pay in 60 days. Now I can tell you that from the standpoint in many countries like Latin America, whatever, that type of draft with the buyer signature is on the top of the charts if there is some kind of financial distress of that company. Like if there's a bankruptcy kind of situation, trade creditors that have those trade drafts are generally paid out of whatever the resources are before banks, before anybody. I mean, it's like at the top of the you know, list. So that's not true in all countries, but in many countries it is. So um, you know, the flow is the same on a collection as a letter of credit, except there is no bank commitment. So there's no instrument, no letter of credit, no commitment on the buyer's bank's part committing to pay. So it's just an agreement between the buyer and the seller, and the seller sends their documents to the bank and says, hey, please forward this to XYZ Bank in Bangladesh for collection. And all we do is forward those documents on behalf of the exporter to the importer's bank on their behalf, but with no obligation. So the next option after an exporter, let's say, has, you know, they've worked with the exporter or buyer for a number of years, they've used letters of credit, they've developed trust, so they move into documentary collections, then maybe the next phase would be to consider giving the buyer open account terms. And somebody's here from Mueller Hurwitz, right? Okay. So if you're doing open account transactions, you know, you can just take that risk with those overseas buyers, and many exporters do. And, you know, if you're selling to the subsidiary of a multinational corporation, maybe you're comfortable with that risk. Or if you're selling to Canada, maybe you're comfortable with that risk. Or, you know, selling to Germany, maybe you're comfortable with that risk. But if you're selling to, you know, maybe smaller companies, companies you don't have a good handle on their financials, you've got a good track record with them, you've got, you know, you've got ledger experience with them, but you don't really know for sure what their financial strength is, or maybe you have a concentration of risk in certain countries, a lot of buyers in certain countries, you might want to look at credit insurance to back up the open account transactions. But basically, this is outside of the banking channels. This is just between the buyer and the seller, open account terms. And I won't cover this in detail, that's Jim's expertise, but you know, basically you can get credit insurance where you're purchasing insurance that protects you against non-payment from your foreign buyers. You can get credit insurance for domestic transactions too, but the thing that many companies, what I've seen over the years, particularly entrepreneurial companies, have to remember is that it's not just like an auto insurance policy that you buy it and you don't even know where you filed it because you got the little card and you're good. There's performance stuff that has to be adhered to, you know. And if a buyer, let's say, goes into protracted default or bankruptcy and you want to file a claim, you better have the documentation necessary to prove that you shipped. You better have the underlying contract. You better have all that stuff. And if there's performance dispute between the seller and the buyer, let's say that the buyer is protracted default, they're not paying, but they claim the reason they're not paying is because the widgets in the box weren't what they ordered. That has to be worked out, you know, and the insurance underwriter is going to, you know, want documentation with regards to all of that, you know, before they're going to settle a claim. So it's not as secure as a letter of credit, but if you're doing open account business and if your client has a good diversification of risk in terms of the buyers and they want this so they can sleep at night, I mean, if I were an exporter and I was selling open account, I would absolutely buy one of these policies. Honestly, the cost is pretty minimal for what you get, in my opinion. So it's something to look into. And if you're using, from the bank's perspective, let's say you, you're going to get a working capital line of credit at your bank. You know, a lot of times your accounts receivable on your balance sheet is an asset that the bank will include in a borrowing base or in the collateral pool. And if the AR is insured, it's not like, it doesn't make that asset like as good as cash, but it improves and enhances the quality of that asset that the bank might be more comfortable lending against. The important thing about that, though, and we remind exporters of this all the time that have credit insurance, is we don't get to file a claim, the bank, against the, let's say that we've made a loan to the exporter and the exporter is running into financial difficulty and we're going to exercise our rights to call on the loan. We can't just go file a claim against the insurance policy because of that. We can only ask the exporter to file the claim if the buyer is in default. So it's not guaranteeing our loan. It's not like an Ex-Im Bank guarantee, which there is another program that does that, but that's not the same as the credit insurance. So this, are they getting the slides? Or will we post this on the website or something? I don't know.
I'll have to check with Kimberly.
Well, if anybody wants it, give your card to Helen and she can get you the presentation, because this is kind of just a cheat sheet of, you know, the pros and cons of all these different methods of payment that I was describing, the various risks to the buyer, the seller, and so forth. I'm happy to answer any questions, but I don't want to bore you by going through everything I've already kind of talked about. Anybody have questions here? So mainly what I've been talking about up to now is a company, let's say, that's based in Illinois, that's sourcing from an overseas vendor, third-party vendor, or who's selling to a client in another country, right? Cross-border trade, unaffiliated relationships, third-party relationships. But as your clients really, let's say, they've been selling to certain buyers in certain markets for quite some time, they may decide that they really want to establish a presence in that country. So they may move into operate from trading with to operating in and move into a country. Again, as strategic advisors to your clients, particularly for companies that are privately held and maybe growing in their global expertise, I personally, and I have been in this business a really long time, I do not suggest to companies that the first step is setting up an office in a country. And when they go to set up, let's say, a joint venture in a country, they may think that's easier because then they got a partner on the ground who can they think can just take care of everything. But have they looked into the labor laws and the partnership laws in that country? Have they looked into how difficult it might be to manage a banking relationship in that country? How are they going to access working capital to support those operations over there? How are they really evaluating that risk? So on the right-hand side of that continuum, as they move into those overseas locations, hopefully they've done a lot of homework and have developed some skill set, on the left-hand side of the continuum before they've done that. You know, because you have the political and safety risks. I mean, honestly, even countries like Mexico, we do a lot of business with Mexico, but the personal safety risks and the risks of your employees and so forth are real. You know, how are they mitigating that? The foreign regulations, I mean, Brazil is just notorious for ridiculous. And I'm a Brazilianist, and so I know Brazil very well. I mean, it's just it's so much opportunity, and from a regulatory point of view, can make you insane. So, you know, how much are they going to invest in time and effort to really develop that level of understanding in a market they're going into? The cultural language differences, you know, no offense, but you go to Brazil and you think you know Spanish and you're going there, guess what? That's not really particularly appreciated. They got more population than all of the rest of Latin America combined. And geographically, they're more than half the geographic expanse of Latin America, and they don't speak Spanish, just to say. So, you know, the financial risk, we've gone through a lot of that. How are they really going to protect their intellectual property, the crime issues, fraud issues, and then the whole, you know, how are they going to integrate their operations? You know, I work with a lot of larger companies too, and very large companies, sophisticated. Getting your ERP system in the United States to integrate with your ERP system in India. I mean, are you kidding me? It's not easy. So there's just a lot of risk and a lot of things to think about. So hopefully they're going to really do their homework and delve into stuff, you know, early on. Hopefully they're going to engage their partners so that they make sure they're pricing things properly. I mean, how many companies do I talk to that they're so excited because the top line number is really big and they're really excited, but have they factored in accurately into their pricing models what it's really going to take to generate a bottom line profitability to this? A long story short is, you know, there's a lot to uncover, but at the end of the day, what I love about international business and why I went into it initially is because it's really fun. It's really exciting. I mean, you know, it's fantastic to have friends and all over the globe and to know people that have a very different perspectives on things. I mean, being isolated and insulated and thinking the American way is the only way is probably not the best way to be mostly successful in today's environment. We can all learn from our global trading partners, and you know. So, anyway, thank you very much, and happy to take any questions.
So we'll just get started. Let me introduce Jessica Platt. She's a vice president of global rates and currencies origination at Bank of America. She's been with Bank of America for about 3 years, and she's a foreign currency advisor supporting our global commercial market and business banking customers with foreign currency risk. And she's located in Chicago. Her coverage map focuses on clients in the central U.S. And prior to Bank of America Merrill Lynch, Jessica was a foreign currency advisor in New York for Citigroup and Credit Suisse, covering ultra-high net worth individuals, family offices, law firms, and institutional clients from an investment, cash, and risk management perspective. Jessica holds Bachelor of Arts degree from University of Pennsylvania. So there she is.
Sure. So as Helen mentioned, Jessica Platt, I'm based here in Chicago, part of the Rates and Currencies team. So our group really focuses on covering clients who deal internationally from an FX perspective. So that includes everything from simple FX payments, receivables, to more strategic risk management and advisory services. So today we're going to cover basically five things, one being the types of FX exposure that companies might face. The advantages of dealing in foreign currency when going international, trends in the FX market and the impact that they've had on some of the companies that we cover, best practices and risk management framework for FX, and then also some hedging products and solutions. So first type of risk that companies might face, which is probably the most common type of FX risk that we see amongst companies, is transactional exposure. So this is really contractual cash flows. So for a company that either sells abroad or a company that has vendors that are located abroad, this is essentially the exchange rate risk from invoice to either payment or receivable. So obviously, you know, you set an invoicing date based off of what the exchange rate is that day. And so that value of what that might cost or how many dollars that you might receive for exchanging that currency at the time that money's received or paid poses exchange rate risk. The second would be economic exposure. So this is really operating exposure, how the market value of a company is influenced by exchange rate fluctuations. And then also, lastly, the demand for goods, which is pretty common, especially right now that we're seeing with companies, is really how a shift in exchange rate influences the demand to sell goods or services abroad, and then also how that impact in exchange rate affects the competitiveness of a company. The third would be translation risk. So this is essentially the extent to which the financial statement is influenced by exchange rate fluctuations. So a company that has assets or liabilities abroad, the need for them to translate that back into the functional currency of, let's say, the US parent would pose translation risk. The fourth being contingent exposure. So an example of this is a company that's, let's say, bidding on a project abroad. So that project is is, or they're bidding on that project in foreign currency. And so that exposure is contingent upon whether or not that bid is accepted. So we see this a lot, again, with companies that are bidding on foreign projects, also with acquisitions or investments. And then essentially, if that bid is accepted, a lot of times it will then go into transactional exposure. So companies that deal internationally or are looking to expand internationally, a lot of times they'll say that they prefer dealing in dollars because they don't want to be exposed to exchange rate fluctuations. And that's a common misconception, because what a lot of companies don't realize is that even if they are dealing in US dollars, most likely they are still being exposed to exchange rate risk. And so companies can get an advantage by dealing in the functional currency of either their customers or their vendors or suppliers. So from a US-based importer perspective, one would be reduced expenses. And the reason for this is because if you have a supplier or a vendor that's located overseas and you're paying them in dollars, they have to account for exchange rate fluctuations, again, from the time that they invoice you until when they receive payment. And so they're taking on the FX risk for receiving US dollars, and therefore are likely building in a premium or a buffer to account for that exchange rate risk that they're taking on, plus the cost of conversion of actually converting those US dollars into euros or Japanese yen or Canadian dollars or whatever their functional currency might be. The other thing too is that for a US-based company who is dealing internationally and their supplier is invoicing them in US dollars, what a lot of times you'll see these vendors or suppliers do is that when the dollar has weakened, they'll increase their cost, right? So they'll increase the cost of their invoices. But when the dollar is strong, like it is right now, they'll see those invoices stay the same. So what US-based companies a lot of times don't realize is that they might be overpaying for the actual cost of goods or services that they're receiving. For example, right now, you know, you look at the dollar compared to the Canadian dollar, for example, right? And it's 25% stronger than it was 2 years ago. Now, if your invoices have remained the same over the last 2 years, you're likely paying that, or your supplier or vendor is technically receiving 25% more than they were 2 years ago. And so that's why we always recommend that companies receive invoices in the functional currency of their vendors or supplier to ensure that they're paying for the actual value of goods or services sold. Guaranteeing promptness, so avoiding the need to deal with intermediary banks, the need for the vendor or supplier to have to convert the currency on their end, and keeping up with emerging trends. For US-based exporter companies that are selling internationally, what it does is it augments the competitiveness of your company because it allows the customer to essentially understand the value or the cost of whatever you're selling abroad in whatever their functional currency is. And so a lot of times, especially if you're dealing with a smaller customer base or a company that doesn't want to take on dealing with the foreign exchange rate risk, again, it will allow you to expand that customer or client base. It also reduces the fees or the hassles that they have to deal with for having to convert that currency into euros or yen or Canadian dollars into US dollars in order to pay you. What a lot of times you don't realize is outside of the currency risk, if they're a small client and they're dealing at their local bank, they might be getting charged 5% just on the conversion fee alone. So it can have a significant impact, again, on expanding your client base internationally. And then a lot of times it allows US-based companies to increase that margin or price, because you eliminating that FX risk for your customer, a lot of times they'll be willing to pay a little bit more because, again, it doesn't compare to the actual cost it will be for them to take on that FX risk and also to have to convert it locally. So the next slide is really just showing kind of the trend of the market over the last 2 years. So as you can see, the dollar has strengthened pretty significantly against really every currency out there, especially in the EM currencies. A lot of this has been mostly driven on monetary policy divergence. So, you know, the Fed hiked rates in December this year for the first time since 2006, and it had been anticipated for a while. Well, you have Europe, Denmark, Sweden, the SMB, Bank of Japan, all cutting rates, and actually even negative interest rate policies, as well as political uncertainty. So this was a survey showing the percent of S&P 500 companies citing a negative impact during Q1 earnings calls. So as you can see, 70% of these companies attributed negative impact to a stronger US dollar. And so two reasons for this is one, because if they're dealing internationally and they're receiving foreign currency and the dollar has strengthened, you know, 25, 30%, 50% even against that foreign currency, they're now, if they haven't adjusted their pricing, they're now receiving 25%, 30%, 50% less than they were 2 years ago. So that's one. And then the second part is for our companies that are maybe smaller, who have historically invoiced their customers in US dollars, it's becoming too expensive for their customers to pay them in US dollars. And so what we're seeing is a lot of companies that, again, historically have invoiced their customers in US dollars, they're getting a lot of that pushback, and they're having difficulty expanding abroad just because it's too expensive. So again, this is just showing kind of where currencies have moved and then also just what our forecasts are. So we really expect the trend to kind of continue for you know, the dollar to appreciate through 2016 and 2017. Okay, so the growth of international trade, you know, has caused companies to expand internationally in a post-recessionary environment, but at the same time, it's kind of created companies are less likely to want to take on that FX risk associated with dealing internationally. So some of the best practices in terms of you know, expanding abroad is looking at the financial risks that the company faces due to the international aspects of their business. What impacts these exposures have had on the business, so cash flows, profits, accounting treatments, how has it affected the value of the company? How does overall management team view these risks? Are they looking to control it? Is it a concern for the company? Has the company employed a financial risk management policy in the past? If yes, what has worked, what hasn't? If no, why? Are they aware of the potential downside that's associated with foreign currency risk? So this is kind of just going through the FX risk management process and kind of the steps in terms of how companies should view it. So the first is identifying and measuring that risk. So what is that foreign exchange risk associated with? And that kind of was the first slide that we went through. You know, is it due to payables, receivables, intercompany transactions, cross-border acquisitions or investments, foreign debt, repatriation of foreign funds? Measuring that risk, so performing some type of sensitivity analysis or scenario analysis. So a lot of times we'll look at evaluate risk, essentially looking at the tail end risk that a company faces with the distribution of returns for changes in currency fluctuations. Setting risk tolerances and hedge horizons, so you know, how much risk is the company willing to take on? From an FX perspective in terms of, you know, exchange rate fluctuations, and also what makes sense in terms of how far the company should look to hedge out. Designing and implementing a strategy, so what's the most appropriate, you know, FX product hedging solution, the amount that the company should hedge, whether it be 50%, 75%, 100% of what their exposure is. And then measuring reporting performance. So, you know, are you hedging against a budget rate or a benchmark rate or a forecasted rate? And how does that hedge perform against that? So there's many products out there in terms of solutions and hedging strategies that companies can look at to manage their FX risk. It can be broken up into kind of two parts. One is an FX forward contract. So essentially, with an FX forward contract, you are locking in a rate today for a value date in the future or for a specific window period. So you don't have the ability to participate in market upside, but you know exactly what your cash flows are going to be. Creates absolute certainty around how much you're going to have to pay or how much you're going to receive. And the way that pricing works, there's no cost per se, but essentially that rate is the spot rate, so today's exchange rate, plus or minus the interest rate differential between the two currencies over that time period. So a currency that is higher yielding will trade at a discount, a currency that's lower yielding will trade at a premium on a forward basis. Options allow for a bit more flexibility, participation in the market. So if a company wants to take a view on where they think the market's going to go, but they at the same time want to be protected on the downside should their view be wrong, they might look at some type of option structure where essentially they are protecting themselves on the downside but allow themselves to participate in market upside as well. So the last page is really just showing every year we do an FX risk management survey. So this was 2015 results. So we survey our customers, our clients that we cover. And what you can see from here is that forecasted exposures are typically the most common reason that companies are hedging. And the most common product by far is an FX forward contract. It's really the most simplistic form of hedging. The way that they hedge through an FX forward can vary. So companies might layer into forward contracts where they're essentially dollar cost averaging into a rate, or they might have a static hedging program through FX forwards. But essentially, in terms of actual product, FX forwards tend to be the most common.
So we can. What are the standard time frames on the forwards?
So there's liquidity in the market, when looking at G10 currencies, really out to 5 years. It's not that common that companies will hedge out that far. I would say the most common time frame is typically out a year, 6 to 12 months. But a lot of it depends on the reason that you're hedging. So for example, if you set a budget rate at the start of the year, a lot of times companies will just want to lock in a profit based off of that budget rate, so they might hedge their full year exposure. Or a company might, let's say, they sell internationally and they reprice their product every 6 months. So they might only hedge out 6 months because what they're doing is they're reflecting that price that they've set at the start to that end of the 6 months, and then once they reevaluate, they'll reprice for another 6 months. So it really just depends in terms of what the FX risk is associated with and what makes sense from a budgeting and forecasting perspective.
So we can just go into asking questions.
Okay. Are there any samples available for the scenario analysis that might be something that a company that is facing the risk of the exchange rates could look at to say, that's kind of like me to drive them to taking action so that they don't get caught into some type of exchange rate issue?
Yeah, I mean, we don't have, typically what we'll do is we'll look at like the volatility of the currency and kind of exchange rate fluctuations. Again, looking at the most common is a value at risk analysis, where you're kind of looking at that tail end of distributions as to what the worst case scenario could potentially be for a company. It involves a bit more market data that, it's not something that's just easily, template. Create into a template and send to a company, just because those volatilities are always changing. So we tend to perform it for clients ourselves, to analyze what the risk might be for a company. So typically they'll send us their exposure and we'll run the analysis ourselves. Yeah.
Find out more.
Exactly.
Did you mention like margin of interest between the foreign currency and the US dollar? And it being kind of a margin, obviously. Can that lead to short payments? Consistent short payments?
Yeah, so I mean, so it kind of works both ways in the sense that, and I kind of go into it a little bit. Here is when you're looking at forwards or actually even options, the interest rate differential, looking at whether or not that's in favor or against the hedger. So a lot of times, for example, if a company is paying in India, right, the Indian rupee on a forward basis trades at a pretty significant discount to the US dollar because of the interest rate differential between the US and India. And so a company might hedge out longer dated because they're getting, you know, a 5-10% discount for hedging out over the next 2 years. And it kind of works on the opposite end as well in terms of, you know, if you, let's say you were selling Indian rupee, the forward points work against you. And so that might cause a company to look at shorter dated scenarios to, you know, avoid paying that interest rate.
Okay, so when you're considering going global, you have to consider all these factors and one omission or one missing information could wipe out your profit that you were anticipating or could put a business out of business, right? So you have, if you look in the room here, we have the partners that you need to get your exporting, the going global to make it happen. We have accounting firms, law firms with global presence and global expertise. And then we have insurance company, Euler, where they can help you make sure you receive your payment. And then we have a logistics company. And as you're starting out, like, Charlotte said, you know, you may not want to initially open an office and start hiring people, you know, in China, but you may want to start out baby steps. And freight forwarding company is a first a good advisor because they do business over there in those countries and they know what works and what doesn't work. And, you know, you can look easily, export.gov, trade.gov. They have a lot of information, loads of information on international trade, webinars, training information, all free of charge. And the export.gov, they go further and they even help you find opportunities overseas in finding distribution channels and putting partners together for you. And then you look at your bank, your global trade team at the bank, and have your team work for you, do some studies and researches for you, and help you pricing and put the transaction together. So there are a lot of resources out there. Just even Illinois Manufacturer Association, they can put you to the right area to get started. So I hope this was helpful.
Yeah, is there any demographics on how many companies just on the letter of credit side? You actually have a Fort Charlotte formal program, as you described it. How many really need to assess it, you know, kind of the opportunity side of companies that should really change what they're doing to protect?
Well, you know, of course, I know the value of letters of credit, so I probably think there's lots and lots of companies that should be looking at those types of strategies who, you know, I'll tell you, letters of credit, what I hear from companies all the time is, oh my God, don't even talk to me about them. They're, oh my God, I did one once and it was a nightmare. Well, you know, when you have your secretary handling the documentation, it's gonna be a problem. You gotta have some expertise. I mean, we have a partner called Trade Technologies that they're a document prep company. So hire somebody like that that's really got the expertise to make sure that the documentation's in order so that the letter of credit is not a pain in the neck, you know? But, you know, I think sometimes entrepreneurs, you know, they're looking for the easiest road and that's not always the best road, you know?
So lots of demand and people need to really assess their risk.
I think that a lot of companies honestly take risks that sometimes are not the best thing to do. I mean, gosh, I knew this guy down in Florida that he had this company and he got this huge order to do this big project at an airport in Latin America, whatever. And he signed that contract without the financial backing to really make it happen. And he didn't structure things properly. And honestly, he had had his company for 10 years and it went down. Yeah. One large order that he didn't manage properly. So it's not a happy ending not to look at the risks.
And we didn't discuss about the Ex-Im Bank and other investment, help that you need if you are considering. Depends on what you want to do, but you know that could be another segment. You know, we can talk to you about it. But for today's session, I think that I'm going to send out the PowerPoint presentation. But in the booklet, it has some references, a guide of what we talked about today, a shorter version. So you can use that as a reference, and then let us know how we can help you, and we'll do what we can to put you in touch with the right party. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.